Got your parcel here, Andrew.
Much obliged.
Say, it's getting so cold the river's gonna freeze up by the flats. I won't keep you long, ma'am.
Oh, don't trouble. I'm more than content to be out of that snow.
Quite a fall, eh? Morning, Ethan.
Morning.
Got Zena's medicine here, if you got a mind to collect it.
Ethan Frome was the most striking figure in Starkfield, even though he was but a ruin of a man.
How is Zena?
About the same.
His lameness checked each step like the jerk of a chain.
You go careful now. We all got our burdens to bear, but I can't help feeling Ethan got more than most.
I had a little of the story from Andrew Hale, who'd known Ethan all his life.
Been like that ever since the smash-up.
Smash-up?
More than enough to kill most men, but the Fromes are tough.
When he was young, Ethan had it in mind to be an engineer. He wanted to be in towns where there were lectures and libraries and fellows doing things. But he was an only child. He had cared first for his father, then his mother, and finally, his wife. According to Andrew Hale, it was Ethan who'd always done the caring. Then, after the accident, he had no choice but to stay.
Miss Wharton, can I help you?
I was going to catch a ride to Corbury Flats to pick up my train for the junction, but Mr. Logan's unable to assist me with all this snow.
I reckon Ethan would take you over.
But I've never even spoken to him. Why on earth should he put himself out for me?
Well, don't know as he would, but he wouldn't be sorry to earn a dollar.
Up now, come on.
For the next week, Ethan Frome drove me every morning to Corbury Flats, and on my return in the afternoon, met me again and carried me back through the icy night to Starkfield. He never turned his face to mine and barely spoke. He seemed a part of the mute, melancholy landscape, an incarnation of its frozen woe. Yet there was nothing unfriendly in his silence. One evening, toward the end of that week, the snow started to fall straight and steadily. It seemed to be part of the thickening darkness, the winter night itself descending on us, layer by layer.
Whoa there!
It's impossible to see anything!
Waste blocked up ahead.
How will we make our way back?
I have to take the lower road.
But that's a good 10 miles.
Not a bail, do it if you give him time. I'll get you there.
You're very kind.
That's all right. Come on now, hop!
Two or three times, some ghostly landmark sprang up to warn us we were astray. And when we finally regained our road, the horse began to show signs of exhaustion.
Let me get out and walk. Ease the burden on the animal.
No.
I insist.
Near enough an hour later, we saw a light in the distance.
That's my house down yonder.
You mustn't go any further.
Nor you neither. This way.
He meant to give me shelter, and I was glad to accept it.
Best leave your things here to dry.
I'm down to my bones. Wish I could sleep as easy as a child. I guess sleep's lost to me. I gotta spend my time waiting for I don't know what.
It was that night that I found the clue to Ethan Frome and began to put together this vision of his story. It all began 20 years before. It was winter, and Starkfield lay under 2 feet of snow. All of the town's waking life was gathered behind the church windows, from which strains of dance music flowed with broad bands of yellow light. Hugging the shadows, so as not to be seen, Ethan Frome craned his neck till he got a glimpse of the room.
You are running me to exhaustion, Miss Silver.
I love dancing.
Ethan watched as Mattie Silver lifted her rapt face to her partner, the Gross's son, Denis Eady. Mattie Silver came from Stamford. She had entered the Frome's household to assist her cousin, Ethan's wife, Zeena. But the truth of it was, she had nowhere else to go. For Ethan, no moments in Mattie's company were comparable to those when he would come into town to walk her back at night to the farm.
Your gentleman friend not showing up, man? Oh, say, I mean, that is tough.
Denis.
No, it wouldn't be mean enough to tell the other girls. I ain't as low down as that.
Ethan Frome watched from the shadows.
But, hey, look here. Ain't it lucky I got the old man's cutter down there just waiting for us.
What's it doing waiting down there?
Why? For you and me to take a ride. I got the roll call, too. I kind of knew I'd want to take a ride tonight.
Mattie seemed to waver.
Hold on a minute while I unhitch the colt.
Ethan watched as Mattie let Denis Eady lead out the horse and fling back the bearskin rug to make room for her at his side.
Goodbye. Hope you'll have a lovely time.
Hey, come along. Get in, quick.
Night. I'm not getting in.
Oh, I guess I can't stop you catching your death of cold if you're fixed on it. Get on!
I think I've forgotten you, Matt.
Ethan! I thought maybe you couldn't come back for me.
Couldn't. What nurse could stop me?
Well, I knew Zeena wasn't feeling any too good today.
Ah, she's in bed long ago. Then, you meant to walk home all alone?
Oh, I ain't afraid.
If you thought I hadn't come, why didn't you ride back with Denis Eady?
Why? Where were you? How did you know? I never saw you.
Come along.
He slipped his arm through hers and fancied it was faintly pressed against her side. Neither of them moved. He would have liked to stand there with her all night in the blackness.
There was a whole lot of people sledging before the moon set. Looked like they were having fun.
Would you like to come in and go coasting one night, Mattie?
Oh, could we, Ethan? That would be lovely.
We'll come tomorrow if there's a full moon.
She lingered, pressing closer to his side.
Ned Hale and Ruth Varnum came near to running into that big elm at the bottom. We were all sure they would be killed. Wouldn't it have been too awful? They're so happy.
Ah, Ned ain't much of steering. I guess I could take you down all right.
That great elm is dangerous, though. It ought to be cut down.
Would you be afraid of it with me?
I told you. I ain't the kind to be afraid.
You'd have found me right off if you hadn't gone back to have that last reel with Denis Eady.
Why, Ethan, how could I tell you were there?
I suppose what folks say is true.
Why? What do folks say?
That it's natural enough you should be leaving us.
You mean that Zeena ain't suited anymore? I know I ain't anything like as smart as I ought to be. And I haven't got much strength in my arms, but if she'd only tell me, I'd try. You know, she hardly ever says anything, and sometimes I can see she ain't suited, and yet I don't know why.
Ethan Frome's wife, Zeena, had never shown any jealousy of Mattie. But of late, she had grumbled increasingly over the housework, and had found oblique ways of drawing attention to the girl's inefficiency.
Come along.
They walked in silence through the blackness of the hemlock-shaded lane into the comparative clearness of the fields. The open country rolled away before them, lonely under the stars.
Then you don't want to leave us, Matt.
Where would I go if I did?
Ethan pressed Mattie Silver against him so closely, he seemed to feel her warmth in his veins.
You ain't crying, are you, Matt?
No. Of course I'm not.
They turned in at the gate and passed under the shaded knoll where, enclosed by a low fence, the Frome gravestones slanted at crazy angles through the snow. Ethan seemed to hear their voices in the stillness of the night. We never got away. How should you?
I'll never let you go, Matt.
Zeena always went to bed as soon as she had supper. The shutterless windows of the house were dark.
The key's not here.
It might have fallen off into the snow.
Zeena, guess you must have forgot about us.
No. I just got my shooting pains so bad, I couldn't sleep.
I'm so sorry, Zeena. Isn't there anything I can do?
No, there's nothing. You might have shook off that snow outside.
While Zeena stood on the stairs, a lamp in her hand, Ethan Frome paused, affecting to fumble for the peg on which he hung his coat. The doors of the two bedrooms faced each other at the top of the stairs, and tonight it was peculiarly repugnant to Ethan that Mattie should see him follow Zeena up to their room.
I guess I won't come up yet a while.
For land's sake, what are you going to do down there?
I've got the mill accounts to go over.
At this time of night? You'll catch your death. The fire's out long ago.
Ethan's glance crossed Mattie's, and he fancied that a furtive warning gleamed through her lashes. The next moment, she began to mount the stairs ahead of Zeena.
That's so. It is powerful cold down here.
And with lowered head, Ethan Frome went up the stairs in his wife's wake and followed her across the threshold of their room. He undressed hurriedly and blew out the light so that he should not see Zena's face when he took his place at her side. He could hear Mattie moving about in her room, her candle sending its small ray across the landing, creeping underneath his door. He kept his eyes fixed on that light till it vanished. Through his tingling veins and tired brain, only one sensation persisted: the warmth of Mattie's shoulder next to his. Ethan Frome had spent the whole of the morning laboring alone in the still, bright air of the woodlot, but all he had been able to think about was Mattie Silver. Why had he not kissed her last night as they stood together in the snow-covered woods? As he entered the kitchen, Mattie was preparing the table, and Zeena was seated in the high-backed chair. She wore her best dress of brown merino, and beside her on the floor stood Ethan's old valise.
Well, where are you going, Zeena?
I've got my shooting pains so bad. I'm going over to Bettsbridge to spend the night with Aunt Martha Pierce and see that new doctor.
Such abrupt decisions were not without precedent in Zena's history. On her last visit to Springfield, she had paid $20 for an electric battery which she had never been able to learn how to use.
If you're too busy with the hauling, I presume you can let Jotham Powell drive me over in time to catch the train at the flats.
Ethan hardly heard what she was saying. During the winter, there was no stage between Starkfield and Bettsbridge. A rapid calculation showed Ethan that Zeena could not be back before the following evening.
All I know is I can't go on the way I am much longer. The pains are clear way down my ankles now, or I'd have walked to Starkfield on my own feet and asked Michael Eady to let me ride over on his wagon to the flats. I'd have had 2 hours to wait at the station, but I'd sooner have done it, even with this cold, than to have you say...
Well, of course, Jotham will drive you over.
Mattie Silver was pouring the coffee. Ethan found himself looking at her, and with an effort, he turned his eyes back to his wife.
I'd take you over myself, only I have to collect the cash for that lumber I'm taking to Andrew Hale.
As soon as the words were spoken, he regretted them. Not only as they were untrue, but because he knew the imprudence of letting Zeena think he was in funds before one of her therapeutic excursions. But just now, his one desire was to be released from what would be an interminably long drive, trapped at Zena's side.
This medicine ain't done me a speck of good. But I guess I might as well use it up. Mattie, if you can get the taste out of this bottle, it'll do for pickles.
So long, Zeena.
Like I said, I ain't got no choice, but I got to go.
You watch out for that drift down by the lower road.
Oh, Ethan, I never heard you come in.
That's Zeena and Jotham on their way. Best get that hauling done. So long, Matt.
So long, Ethan.
When Ethan's mother was living through the last of her days, his cousin, Zenobia Pierce, came over from the next valley to help nurse her. After the funeral, when he saw her preparing to go away, he was seized with an unreasoning dread of being left alone on the farm, and before he knew what he was doing, he had asked her to stay and marry him. He had often thought since that it would not have happened if his mother had died in spring and not winter.
Hello, Ethan. This lumber sure comes in handy.
Mr. Hale.
Well, sir, you keep these two horses as if they was pets. When you finished unloading, come right inside. Shake the cold off.
I will, thank you.
You sit right down and thaw out. I seen Zeena heading over to the flats. How is she?
Says there's some new doctor over Bettsbridge.
Oh, I'll tell Mrs. Hale Zeena ain't feeling so good. I'm sorry to hear that, Ethan. Can I do something for you?
I was thinking about payment.
For the lumber?
I was wondering about an advance. $50?
$50 advance? What are you doing, Ethan? Buying a piano? Because I got one up at the house you can have for half that price.
No, ain't nothing like that.
Thing is, Ethan, it ain't possible. Not right now.
I'm obliged.
See here, you ain't in a tight place, are you?
Not a bit.
Well, that's good. Because I am. A shade. Fact is, I was going to ask you to give me a little extra time on this payment. Business is pretty slack to begin with, and then I'm fixing up a little house for Ned and Ruth when they're married. I'm glad to do it for them, but it costs. The young people like things nice. You know how it is yourself. It's not so long ago since you fixed up your own place for Zeena.
Up now.
All day long, Ethan Frome had thought about his return to Mattie that evening. For the first time, they would be alone together indoors, and they would sit there, one on each side of the stove, like a married couple.
Come on now.
He in his stockinged feet smoking his pipe, she laughing and talking in that funny way she had, which was always as new to him as if he had never heard it before. As he drew near the house, he saw a light at an upstairs window.
Whoa.
She's up in her room, he said to himself, fixing herself up for supper.
Hello, Matt.
Hello! What? I nearly tripped over you.
Well, Matt, any visitors?
Yes, one.
Who was that?
Why, Jotham Powell. He came in after he got back and asked for a drop of coffee before he went home.
That all? Well, I hope you made out to let him have it. I suppose he got Zeena over to the flats all right.
Oh, yes, in plenty of time. I guess it's about time for supper.
They drew their seats up to the table, and the cat, unbidden, jumped between them into Zena's chair.
Oh, puss.
Looks as if there'd be more snow.
That's so. Oh, do you suppose it'll interfere with Zena's getting back?
Well, you never can tell this time of year. Drifts so bad on the flats.
Oh, puss, not the milk.
They both leaned out, and their fingers touched as they reached for the milk jug.
Oh, Ethan! Ethan, it's all to pieces! What'll Zeena say?
Well, she'll have to say it to the cat, whatever it is. It was he who broke the dish.
Yes, but you see, she never meant it should be used, not even when there was company. And I had to get up on the stepladder to reach it down from the top shelf of the china cupboard where she keeps her best things, and she'll want to know why I did it.
Well, she needn't know anything about it if you keep quiet. I'll get another just like tomorrow. Where did it come from? I'll go to Chad's Falls if
no,
I have to.
No, you'll never get another even there. It was a wedding present, don't you remember? It came all the way from Philadelphia from Zena's aunt that married the minister. That's why she wouldn't ever use it. Oh, Ethan! Ethan, what in the world shall I do?
Don't, Matt, don't. Oh, don't. Here. Give the pieces to me. I'll lay the pieces up here. It's too high for Zeena to see. I get some glue. Tomorrow, it could be a long time before Zeena notices, and by then I'll find a match for the dish in Shad's Falls on Bedsbridge. It's all right, Matt. It's all right. Now come on, come and finish supper.
After supper, while Mattie cleared the table, Ethan went to look at the cows, and he took a last turn about the house and stable. The earth lay dark under a muffled sky, and the air was so still that now and then he heard a lump of snow come thumping down from a tree far off on the edge of the woodlot. When he returned to the kitchen, Mattie had pushed his chair up to the stove, while she sat at the table with a bit of sewing. He felt like he was in another world.
Come over here, ma'am. Sit by the stove. Everything's quiet outside.
They spoke of everyday things. It produced in Ethan an illusion of long-established intimacy, which no outburst of emotion could have given, and he allowed himself to imagine that they had always spent their evenings this way and would always go on doing so.
This was the night we were meant to have gone coasting.
I thought you forgot.
No, I didn't forget. But it's dark as Egypt outdoors. We might go tomorrow if there's a moon.
That would be lovely, Ethan.
Would you be scared to go with me on a night as dark as this?
I ain't any more scared than you are.
Well, I'd be scared then. There's an ugly corner down by the big elm. If the fellow didn't keep his eyes open, he'd go plumb into it. I guess we're well enough here.
Yes, we're well enough here.
Say, Matt. What do you think I saw coming along home today? A friend of yours getting kissed.
I suppose it was Ruth and Ned.
I suppose they'll be setting the date before long.
Yes. I shouldn't wonder if they got married sometime along in the summer.
It'll be your turn next.
Why do you keep on saying that?
Guess I do it to get used to the idea.
It's not because you think Zena's got anything against me, is it?
Why? What do you mean?
I don't know. I thought last night she seemed to have.
I'd like to know what.
Nobody can tell with Zena. She hasn't said anything to you?
No, not a word.
I guess I'm just nervous then. I'm not going to think about it anymore.
No. Don't let's think about it.
Mattie sat sewing, and it seemed to Ethan that a warm current flowed toward him along the strip of cloth that she was mending. Without knowing what he was doing, he leant forward, took the white linen between his fingers, and kissed it.
It's getting late.
Just as on every other night, Mattie dragged toward the stove the old soapbox, lined with carpet in which the cat made its bed. She lifted the two geranium pots, moving them away from the cold window, and he followed her with the hyacinth bulbs in the cracked custard bowl. He put the candlestick in her hand, and she went out of the kitchen ahead of him, the light that she carried before her making her dark hair look like a drift of mist on the moon.
Good night, Matt.
Good night, Ethan.
When the door of her room had closed on her, he remembered he had not even touched her hand.
Morning, Ethan. I got some hot coffee just about ready.
After the previous evening, spent sitting quietly with Mattie Silver, Ethan Frome did not know why he was so irrationally happy, for nothing had changed in his life or hers.
That's good.
He had not even touched the tip of her fingers or looked her full in the eyes, but their time together had given him a vision of what life at her side might be. And he was glad now that he had done nothing to trouble the sweetness of the picture.
Come down the hill road. Must have iced up bad in the night.
Got a load of lumber to take into town later.
Say he's gonna milden as the day goes on.
And the sky's dark. Could close in. I reckon we should waste no time. Sooner I deliver that timber and get back, the better.
Miss Frome will be glad to get home in this weather.
You go harness the greys, Jotham. I won't be long.
For a moment, Ethan and Mattie had the kitchen to themselves. He stood looking at her, his heart in his throat. He wanted to say, "We shall never be alone like this again."
Zeena will be so angry if she finds out I broke her dish.
Don't trouble, Mattie. I'll take the wagon into town just as soon as I can. Get some glue. And Zeena won't be back before dark. By then, that old pickle dish will look as good as new.
Get on, hop!
As soon as the wagon was loaded with timber, Ethan had planned to send Jotham back to the farm while he made his way into town to buy the glue for the broken dish, the pickle dish that Zeena held in such high regard.
Just go easy. Road's iced up pretty bad.
With ordinary luck, Ethan should have had more than enough time to carry out his plan. But everything went wrong right from the start.
Whoa there! Whoa!
Steady, boy! Steady, steady.
Is the leg broke?
He's down heavy.
Bind up the harness. Let's try to get him on his feet.
Steady now. I know.
Cut his knee bad, but it ain't broke.
Knee's binding. I could walk back to the house, get a rag.
No, I'll go. You stay here.
Shh. What's happened?
One of the bays cut his leg. Gotta bind up the wound.
Oh. Here. This is some old linen I use for mending.
Oh, I'm grateful to you.
Jotham said he was going to pick up Zeena early, before it gets dark.
It don't matter. I still got time to get that glue. You believe me, don't you, Matt?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, that should do it. The rag will keep the wound clean enough till we get him back later.
I got some tarpaulin. Could rig it up, give the horse some cover.
We don't have no time to waste on no tarpaulin.
No, sir.
It was what Jotham called a sour day for work, and the horses, shivering and stamping under their wet blankets, seemed to like it as little as the men. It was past the dinner hour when the job was finally done.
That's the last one. You can rope him down, Jotham.
When we get back, I'll go and take the bay that ain't hurt himself to fetch Miss Frome.
Take the sorrel.
The sorrel? But she sure is slow, and with the weather coming down.
Now I need the bay to go to town. You take the sorrel to fetch Zeena. That horse will do it if you give her time. Hup, get on!
Ethan Frome had driven halfway to the village when, in the distance, he saw Jotham Powell urging the reluctant sorrel toward the flats. His time was running out. When Ethan arrived at Michael Eady's store, Eady and his assistant were both down the street, and young Denis Eady, who seldom deigned to take their place, was lounging by the stove.
Well, it looks as if we're all sold out of glue, but if you wait around till the old man comes along, maybe he can put his hand on it.
No, I'm obliged to you, but I'll try down Mrs. Holman.
Miss Holman ain't had no new stock in these last 10 years.
We got corset laces, tin tacks, tapers for candles. Ain't a bad price, neither.
You sure you ain't got any glue?
You thought about trying a good flour paste instead, but Zeena knows how to make one out.
I'd be obliged for some glue.
Cough lozenges, cherry... Oh, well, I'll be... Here it is. One bottle of glue. That'll be 10 cents.
Here.
I hope Zeena ain't broke anything she set store by.
Ethan.
You see here, Matt, I've got some stuff to mend the dishes. Now you let me get
it
quick.
Oh, Ethan, Zena's come.
But Jotham ain't back yet. The sorrel's not in the barn.
He dropped Zeena off, then took the sleigh over to his place. He picked up some groceries for his wife.
How is she?
I don't know. She went right up to her room.
She didn't say anything?
No.
I better go and feed the horses before it gets dark. Don't fret. I'll come down and mend the dish in the night when she's asleep.
From the stable, Ethan Frome could just about see the glow of light that Mattie Silver was making in the kitchen a few yards away. There was no light upstairs in Zena's room. She might be sleeping. Maybe she was tired from her journey.
Ethan? I'll bed it down and then I'll be on my way.
Must have made good time from the flats. You might as well come back for a bite to eat.
The hired man was seldom loath to accept a meal not included in his wages.
I'm obliged to you, but I guess I'll go along home.
Ethan had been hoping for Jotham's neutralizing presence at the table.
You'd be welcome, Jotham. You know that.
I know, but I guess I'll go along back.
There was something vaguely ominous in this stolid rejection of food and warmth. And Ethan wondered what had happened on the drive home with Zeena to cause Jotham to want to get away without delay.
Zeena? Zeena? Supper's about ready. Ain't you coming?
I don't feel as if I could touch a morsel.
Well, I presume you're tired after the long ride.
No, oh, I'm a great deal sicker than you think.
I hope that's not so, Zeena.
No. I've got complications.
Ethan knew the word for one of exceptional import. People struggled on for years with troubles, but they almost always succumbed to complications.
Is that what the new doctor told you?
He says anyone else would want me to have an operation.
What do you know about that doctor anyway? Nobody ever told you that before.
Oh, I didn't need to have anybody tell me I was losing ground every day. And everybody in Bettsbridge knows about Dr. Buck. He has his office in Worcester and comes over once a fortnight to Shad's Falls and Bettsbridge for consultations. Eliza Spears was wasting away with kidney trouble before she went to him, and now she's up and around, singing in the choir.
Oh, well, I'm glad of that. Well, you must do just what he tells you.
I mean to.
What does he want you should do?
He wants I should have a hired girl. He says I oughtn't to have to do a single thing around the house.
A hired girl?
Yes. And Aunt Martha found me one right off. Everybody said I was lucky to get a girl come away out here, and I agreed to give her a dollar extra to make sure. She'll be over tomorrow afternoon.
If you meant to engage a girl, you ought to have told me before you started.
How could I tell you before I started? How did I know what Dr. Buck would say?
Well, did Dr. Buck tell you how I was to pay her wages?
No, he didn't. For I'd have been ashamed to tell him that you grudged me the money to get back my health when I lost it nursing your own mother.
You lost your health nursing mother?
Yes, and my folks all told me at the time that you couldn't do no less and marry me after.
You know, I haven't got the money to pay for a girl, Zeena. You'll have to send her back. I can't do it.
The doctor says it'll be my death if I go on slaving the way I've had to.
You shan't lift a finger if he says so. I'll do everything around the house myself.
You're neglecting the farm enough already.
I haven't got the money, and that settles it.
I thought you were getting $50 from Andrew Hale for the lumber.
Andrew Hale never pays under 3 months. You know that.
He had hardly spoken when he remembered the excuse he had made for not accompanying Zeena to the station the day before.
Why, you told me yesterday you'd fixed it up with him to pay cash down. That was why you couldn't drive me over to the flats.
Ethan had never before been convicted of a lie, and all the resources of evasion failed him.
I guess that was a misunderstanding.
You ain't got the money?
No.
And you ain't going to get it?
No.
Well, I couldn't know that when I engaged the girl now, could I?
You know it now. I'm sorry, but it can't be helped. You're a poor man's wife, Zeena. But I'll do the best I can for you.
Oh, I guess we'll make out.
Of course we will.
There'll be Maddie's board less anyhow.
Maddie?
Well, you didn't suppose I was going to keep two girls, did you? No wonder you were scared of the expense.
Maddie's not a hired girl. She's your relation.
She's a pauper, and I've already kept her a whole year. It's someone else's turn now.
Ethan? Zeena, do you know what time it is? Supper's been ready half an hour.
Oh, go along down, Matt. Zeena's just a little tired. I'm coming. You ain't gonna do it, Zeena.
Do what?
Send Maddie away like this.
I never bargained to take her for life.
You can't put her out of the house, poor girl with no friends or money. What'll folks say of you?
I know well enough what they say about me, having kept her as long as I have.
Ethan Frome looked at his wife with loathing. She was no longer the listless creature who had lived at his side in a state of sullen self-absorption, but a mysterious, evil presence, a dark energy secreted from the long years of silent brooding.
The girl will be over from Bettsbridge tomorrow. She'll be needing a place to sleep. Mattie can pack her things tonight. I dare say Jotham Powell can take her to the station.
There had never been anything in Zeena that one could appeal to, but as long as Ethan could ignore and command, he had remained indifferent. Now she had mastered him, and he abhorred her. All the long misery of his baffled past, of his youth, of failure, hardship, and vain effort rose up in his soul in a wave of bitterness which seemed to take shape before him in the woman who at every turn had barred his way. She had taken everything from him, and now she meant to take the one thing that made up for all the rest. By nightfall tomorrow, Mattie Silver would be gone. Ethan sat down with Mattie for what he feared would be the very last time, and a sense of dread hung over him so real, so close, that he barely dared to speak, in case in speaking, what he feared the most might come to pass.
I've been keeping it nice and hot. Get down, pussy. I hope Zeena isn't sick.
No.
Well, you best start. You must be starving. I know, puss. You'll have your supper, too. Why, Ethan, what's the matter? Don't it taste right?
Yes, it's first rain. Only...
Oh, Ethan... There's something wrong. I knew there was.
Oh, Matt.
What is it?
Mattie. I can't let you go, Matt. I can't. I won't let you.
Go? Must I go?
The words went on sounding between them like a torch of warning passed from hand to hand through a black landscape.
Ethan, what's happened? Is Zeena mad with me?
No, it's not that. But the new doctor is scared her about herself. You know, she believes all they say the first time she sees him. And this one's told her that she won't get well unless she lays up and don't do a thing about the house. Not for months.
And she wants somebody handier to take my place, is that it?
That's what she says tonight.
If she says it tonight, she'll say it tomorrow.
Both now bowed to the inexorable truth. They knew that Zeena never changed her mind, and that in her case, a resolve once taken was equivalent to an act performed.
Don't be too sorry, Ethan.
Oh, God.
You're letting your supper get cold.
Matt. Where'll you go?
I might get something to do over Stamford.
Despair seized him at the thought of her setting out alone. In the only place where she was known, she was surrounded by indifference and animosity. What chance had she, inexperienced and untrained, among the million bread seekers in the city?
You can't go, Matt. I won't let you. She's always had her way. But I mean to have mine now.
I felt a mite better. Dr. Buck says I ought to eat all I can to keep my strength up, even if I ain't got any appetite. Good pussy. I got you a bit of supper here now. There you go. See?
They got snow as bad in Bettsbridge?
Not so bad. It's a big place. They gotta keep the street open. You want more pie, Ethan?
No, I had mine.
Dr. Buck says half the people of this country don't eat right. Dr. Buck says we gotta work with what we got. No use wishing for what you can't never have, is there?
I'll clear away those plates, shall I?
That pie of yours always sits a mite heavy, Matt. I have a good mind to go and hunt up those stomach powders I got last year over in Springfield. I ain't tried them for quite a while. Maybe they'll help my heartburn.
Can I get them for you, Zeena?
No. No. They're in a place you don't know about.
Guess I'll go outside and take a look around.
I'd like to know who done this. I went to get those powders I'd put away in Father's old spectacle case. Top of the china closet, where I keep the things I set store by, so's folks shan't meddle with them. And I put Aunt Philura Maple's pickle dish up there on purpose when we was married. And it's never been down since, except for the spring cleaning. And then I always lifted it with my own hand so it shouldn't get broke. I want to know who done this.
I can tell you then. The cat did.
The cat?
That's what I said.
I'd like to know how the cat got into my china closet.
Chasing mice, I guess. There was a mouse around the kitchen all evening.
I knew the cat was a smart cat. But I didn't know he was smart enough to pick up the pieces of my pickle dish and lay them edge to edge on the very shelf. He knocked them off.
It wasn't Ethan's fault, Zeena. The cat did break the dish, but I got it down from the china closet. And I'm the one to blame for getting it broken.
You got down my pickle dish? What for?
I wanted to make the supper table pretty.
You wanted to make the supper table pretty? And you waited till my back was turned and took the thing I most set store by of everything I got and would never use it, not even when the minister come to dinner or Aunt Martha Pierce come over from Bettsbridge. Oh, you're a bad girl, Mattie Silver, and I always known it. It's the way your father begun, and I was warned of it when I took you, and I tried to keep my things where you couldn't get them. And now you have taken from me the one thing I cared for most of all. If I'd listened to folks, you'd have gone before this, and this wouldn't have happened.
And with that, she gathered up the bits of broken glass and went out of the room as if she was carrying a dead body. The kitchen was empty when Ethan came back inside from walking his nightly round. His tobacco pouch and pipe had been laid on the table, and under them a scrap of paper torn from the back of a seedman's catalogue, on which three words were written.
Don't trouble, Ethan.
It was the first time Mattie had ever written to him. When Ethan was called back to the farm by his father's illness, his mother gave him, for his own use, a small room behind the best parlor. Here he nailed up shelves for his books, built himself a box sofa out of boards and a mattress. He hung on the rough plaster wall an engraving of Abraham Lincoln and a calendar with thoughts from the poets. When Mattie came, he had to give her his stove, and now, in winter, it was as cold as could be.
Don't trouble. Don't. Trouble.
He read Mattie's message again and again. The possession of the paper gave him a strange sense of her nearness, yet it deepened his anguish by reminding him that from now on they would have no other way of communicating with each other. Confused emotions of rebellion raged in him. He was too young, too strong, too full of the sap of living to submit so easily to the destruction of his hopes. He knew of a man over the mountain. He had escaped from just such a life of misery by going west with the girl he cared for.
Zeena, I've done all I could for you, and I don't see it's been any use. I don't blame you, nor do I blame myself. Maybe both of us will do better separate.
If he gave the farm to Zeena, what would be left for him to start his own life with? Once in the West, he was sure of picking up work. He would not have feared to venture there alone. Although with Mattie depending on him, it would not be easy.
I'm going to try my luck in the West. You can sell the farm. Oh, keep the money.
But the farm was mortgaged to the limit, and even if Zeena found a purchaser, it was doubtful she would clear $1,000 on the sale. And how could she keep the farm going? She could never carry such a burden alone.
Damn it!
He had a copy of the Bettsbridge Eagle.
Trips to the West, reduced rates, $40?
A moment ago, he had wondered what he and Mattie were to live on when they reached the West. Now he saw he had not even the money to take her there. Borrowing was out of the question. He had given his only security to raise funds for repairs to the mill, and he knew that without security, no one would lend him $10 in Starkfield. There was no way out. None. He was a prisoner for life, and his one ray of light had been extinguished. Oh. Ethan awoke to the chill of the winter dawn. He went to the window. A red sun stood over the gray rim of the fields behind trees that looked black and brittle. All he could think of was that this would be Mattie's last day.
Oh, Ethan, were you here all night? You must be frozen.
How did you know where I was?
I went to bed and you didn't come up. I listened for you all night.
I'll come along and make up the kitchen fire. I got your note. I don't want you to trouble either.
No, Ethan. I ain't going to trouble.
I guess things will straighten out. Zeena ain't said anything this morning.
No, I haven't seen her yet.
No, don't you take any notice when you do. Things will work out. You'll see. Things look different in the light of a new day.
That's what I always say.
Well, I guess we must have it right then.
And as they drank their coffee, it was as if, for a little while at least, they had regained their own private world, and any thought of parting was left lingering in the shadows of the day that was yet to come. When warmth began to radiate from the stove and the first ray of sunshine lay on the kitchen floor, it seemed to Ethan impossible that Mattie should ever cease to be part of his life.
Daniel Burns going over to the flats today noon. Said he'd take Mattie's trunk along and make it easier riding when he takes her over in the sleigh.
Who asked him to do that?
Why, I did. The new girl will be at the flats at 5. He can take Mattie along so she can catch the train for Stamford.
I'm much obliged to you, Zeena.
I'd like to go over a few things first. There's a huckabuck towel missing, and I can't make out what you've done with the copper matchbox used to stand behind the stuffed owl in the parlor.
It had occurred to Ethan that Andrew Hale, who was a kind-hearted man, might be induced to reconsider his previous refusal and advance a payment on some lumber if he were told that Zena's ill health made it necessary to hire a servant. With $50 in his pocket, nothing could keep him from Matty Silver.
Whoa there, whoa!
Good morning, Ethan!
Miss Hale? Mr. Hale up at the house?
Why, yes! He ain't going to his work this forenoon. He woke up with a touch of lumbago, and I just made him put on one of Dr. Kidder's plasters and set right up to the fire.
I'm sorry to hear that.
I only just heard from Mr. Hale about Zeena going over to Bettsbridge to see the new doctor. I'm real sorry to hear she's feeling bad again. I don't know anyone round here had more sickness than Zeena.
No.
I always tell Mr. Hale, I don't know what she'd have done if she hadn't had you to look after her. And I used to say the same thing about your mother. Ah, you had an awful mean time, Ethan Frome. Up,
up, up. It was a long time since anyone had spoken to Ethan as kindly as Mrs. Hale. And for the first time, he saw what he was about to do.
Go on now.
He was a poor man, the husband of a sickly woman. If he deserted her, she would be alone and destitute. And even if he had the heart to leave her, he could only have done so by deceiving two kindly people who had pitied him.
Got your bag? Did Zeena say goodbye?
I think she must be sleeping.
Here, let me help you. Now then, go on. We got lots of time for a good ride, man.
His hand reached for hers, and he pressed her fingers in his.
Are you going round by the shadow pond?
I knew you'd know.
They drove slowly up the road between fields glistening under the pale sun. The lane passed into a pine wood, and as they entered, a warm stillness seemed to fall from the branches with the dropping needles.
Whoa, now.
This is where we had the picnic.
Remember I found your locket?
Oh, I never saw anybody with such a sharp eye.
You're pretty as a picture in that pink hat.
We mustn't stay here any longer.
There's plenty of time.
They looked at each other, straining to remember the moment forever.
Go along. Matt, what do you mean to do?
I'll try to get a place in a store.
You know you can't do it. The bad air and the standing nearly killed you before.
I'm a lot stronger than I was when I came to Starkfield.
Isn't there any of your father's folks could help you?
There isn't any of them I'd ask.
You know, there's nothing I wouldn't do for you if I could.
I know there isn't.
But I can. Oh, Matt, if I could have gone with you now, I'd have done it. Would you have wanted to be with me?
Oh, Ethan. Ethan, what's the use?
Tell me.
I used to think of it sometimes. Summer nights. When the moon was so bright I couldn't sleep.
As long ago as that. I'm tied hand and foot, Matt. There isn't a thing I can do.
You must write to me sometimes, Ethan.
Oh, what good will writing do? I want to put my hand out and touch you. I want to do for you and care for you. I want to be there when you're sick and when you're lonesome.
You mustn't worry, so I'll be all right.
Oh, you won't need me, you mean. I suppose you'll marry.
Oh, Ethan!
I don't know how it is you make me feel, Matt. I'd almost rather you were dead than that.
I wish I was. Oh, I wish I was.
Don't let's talk this way.
Why shouldn't we when it's true? I've been wishing it every minute of the day.
Matt, you be quiet. Don't you say it.
There's never anybody been good to me but you.
Don't you say that either when I can't lift a hand to help you.
I know. But it's true just the same.
They had reached the crest of the Corbury Road.
Whoa.
An icy slope stretched away before them. It was where the young people of the town came to coast and make merry on starry winter nights.
How'd you like to come coasting with me, Matt? We said we would, didn't we?
Why, there isn't time.
There's all the time we want. Come along.
But the girl, she'll be waiting at the station.
Let her wait. Come on. There's a sled over there. I'll just put a blanket on the horse and then I'll take you down.
She seated herself obediently on the sled, and he took his place behind her.
All right, Matt.
It's dreadfully dark. Are you sure you can see?
I could go down this coast with my eyes shut.
Nevertheless, he sat still a moment, straining to see down the long hill.
Here we go! Don't be scared, Matt! Were you scared I'd run into that elm?
I told you, I'm never scared with you.
There's a tricky place, though. At least swerve, we never come back up again. I guess this sled must be Ned Hale's. I'll leave it where I found it.
Is this where Ned and Ruth kissed each other? Oh, Ethan.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Matt, I can't let you go. What do we do?
It's time.
You don't suppose I'm gonna leave you now?
If I miss my train, where'd I go?
Where are you gonna go if you catch it? What's the good of either of us going anywhere without the other now?
Ethan, I want you to take me coasting one more time, so we'll never come up anymore.
What do you mean?
Right into the big elm. So we'd never have to leave each other again.
What are you talking about? You're crazy.
Where will I go if I leave you? I don't know how to get along alone. Nobody but you was ever good to me. And there'll be that strange girl in the house. She'll sleep in my bed where I used to lay nights and listen to hear you come up the stairs. Come on.
She reached for his hand. The slope below them was deserted. He took his seat on the sled, and Mattie instantly placed herself in front of him.
Get up.
No.
I want to sit in front.
Well, how can you steer in front?
I don't have to. We'll follow the track.
Why do
Get up.
Well, why do you want to sit in front?
Because I want to feel you holding me.
He felt for the tracks worn in the ice by those young people who had gone before and placed the runners of the sled carefully between the edges. Her breath on his neck set him shuddering again, and he almost sprang from his seat. But in a flash, he remembered the alternative. She was right. This was better than parting. He leaned back and drew her mouth to his.
I'm ready.
Halfway down, there was a sudden drop. As the sled took wing, it seemed to Ethan that they were flying indeed. Far up into the cloudy night, with Starkfield immeasurably below them, falling away like a speck in space. As the great elm came into sight below them, Mattie pressed her arms around Ethan, and her blood seemed to be in his veins.
Mine's cold here. The fire must be most out.
And so it was that I found the clue to Ethan Frome and began to put together this vision of his story.
The fire's only just been made up this very minute. Zeena fell asleep, and I thought I'd be frozen stiff before I could wake her up.
There ain't no wood in the woodpile, Ethan.
This is my wife.
Mrs. Frome?
And Miss Mattie Silver. I'll go fetch some logs for the stove.
I seated myself in the poor-looking kitchen, with Ethan's wife, Zeena, and Mattie Silver, wasted and grown old. It was said in town that when Zeena heard of the accident, she stayed with Ethan over at the minister's where they'd carried him. And as soon as the doctors said Mattie could be moved, Zeena sent for her and took her back to the farm. Mattie never had the use of her legs again, needed Zeena for every little thing. And Zeena did for her, and did for Ethan as best she could. And people thought that strange, because before the accident, she couldn't even care for herself.
Snow's coming down even harder now.
Is it, Ethan?
We ain't all burned up with the heat. We're froze with the cold. Ain't nothing we can do about it.
Some said it was a pity that Mattie Silver survived. If she had died, then Ethan might have lived, instead of them all being shut up in that kitchen with not a dime to spare. It was terrible indeed to hear the two old women go on at each other, and to see the pain on the face of Ethan Frome. It was possible that he had suffered most of all. And as the night darkened, and every creature took shelter from the cold, it seemed to me there wasn't much difference now between the Fromes up at the farm and the Fromes down in the graveyard, lying silent, frozen, under the drifting snow.
In Ethan Frome by Edith Wharton, Ethan was played by Dominic Mafham and Mattie by Jessica Raine. Zeena was Laurle Lefkow, Mrs. Hale was Tracy Wiles, Mr. Hale was Paul Moriarty, Denis Eady was Christopher Webster, the postmistress was Adjoa Andoh, and Widow Howman was played by Victoria Inez Hardy. Ethan Frome was dramatised by Lin Coghlan and directed by Sally Avens.